Zoster, herpes zoster, or shingles, is an acute manifestation of a chronic viral infection. An acute manifestation characterized by the appearance of blisters and pain along a dermatome. And a chronic viral infection caused by the varicella zoster virus, an enveloped, double-stranded DNA herpes virus. Yeah, who could have guessed that the virus that causes herpes zoster is a herpes virus? Shocking, I know. I guess you don't have to be a genius either to guess which other disease the varicella zoster virus causes apart from zoster. Well, it's varicella or chickenpox in case you thought there was a catch. So, the first point to establish about the disease shingles or zoster is that it's caused by the very same virus that causes chickenpox or varicella. Actually, I don't mean the same species of virus. I actually mean the very same viruses that infected the patient when he was a child, mostly. You see, shingles is an acute manifestation of a chronic viral infection, meaning, like many other viruses, such as HIV or HCV, once you get infected by varicella zoster, your body is unlikely to ever succeed in completely clearing it out on its own. You may get better from chickenpox, but the virus will never be completely eradicated from your body. Rather, it will take refuge in your nervous system, precisely in the dorsal sensory ganglia. By the way, if neuroanatomy is not your strongest subject, ganglia are groups of cell bodies outside of the central nervous system. There, it will hide for years or decades, avoiding your immune system until you become old or ill and your immune system falters. Then, it will seize the opportunity by leaving the ganglia and spreading once more throughout your body. Since it was lodged in a ganglion, a group of neuron bodies, however, the most obvious and practical path for its spreading will be along the trajectory of the very same sensory nerve it was sitting upon. Thus, it will cause neuropathic pain, pain of nervous origin, on that nerve sensory area, and manifest its lesions, blisters, along the corresponding portion of skin innervated by that nerve. The area of skin innervated by the sensory fibers of a single spinal nerve is called a dermatome. Less commonly, in up to 15% of cases, the sensory ganglia of a cranial nerve rather than a spinal nerve may be the origin of reactivation, leading to pain blisters in the head, in the trajectory of a cranial nerve. This is seen in the trigeminal nerve in herpes zoster ophthalmicus of the eye, or in the geniculate ganglion of the facial nerve in herpes zoster otticus of the ear. So, we have established that 1. Shingles is an acute manifestation of a chronic viral infection by the varicella zoster virus. 2. The virus remains dormant in the dorsal ganglia for many years or decades after the first infection. 3. Reactivation is usually due to a lower immune response from illness or old age. And 4. It manifests as neuropathic pain and blisters along a dermatome. Since nerves are mirrored, that is, we have a left and a right one, the rash and pain will usually be unilateral. Involvement of multiple or bilateral dermatomes usually indicates the immune system is completely losing control of the situation and is more commonly seen in immunocompromised patients such as AIDS and transplantation patients. The blisters or grouped herpetiform vesicles on an erythematose base usually appear 2 to 3 days after the pain first starts. Shingles is typically self-limited and does not offer significant risk of death in the immunocompetent, with lesions healing within a month. However, owing to severe pain the first weeks, treatment is often warranted. Since we are talking about the reactivation of a viral infection, an antiviral drug, usually acyclovir, is started in the first 72 hours of symptoms onset and continued for 7 to 10 days and crusting of the lesions. The antiviral use shortens the length of the disease and decreases the risk of post-herpetic neuralgia, but its usefulness is dependent on early start. Since the virus is spread along nerves, long-term or even permanent nerve damage is possible, which manifests as neuropathic pain even after the herpes zoster infection has been again driven back to the dorsal roof ganglia. Other theories for post-herpetic pain etiology also exist. Post-herpetic neuralgia is the most common complication of shingles and may last anything from 2 weeks to improve to never fully disappearing. Around half of patients over 70 years of age may present pain lasting for more than a year. Most common in the very elderly and or in instances of upper body or head involvement, it's treated habitually as a typical neuropathic pain with amitriptyline, pregabalin, or gabapentin. Neuropathic pain is usually described as burning or electric shock-like. Rarer complications exist, such as palsy from motor involvement and encephalomyelitis, but these are generally restricted to immunocompromised patients. Complications associated with special sensory organs, such as the eyes and the ears, are present only when the zoster affects cranial nerves. Diagnosis is usually clinical, with limited gain from laboratory studies such as PCR of the vesicular fluid. This tends to be more useful in atypical presentations, such as zoster presentation without blisters. Antiviral treatment is more useful the earlier it's started. Varicella zoster infection is contagious, and patients are infectious until lesions crust and dry up. However, shingles is the presentation arising from reactivation, meaning if someone with no previous immunity to varicella zoster virus, chickenpox or vaccine, has contact with someone with shingles, he or she is likely to develop chickenpox, the primary presentation, and not zoster. There is both a varicella zoster live vaccine and a newer recombinant vaccine. The live vaccine is used for prevention of both varicella in the young and zoster in the elderly, whereas the recombinant is particularly applied in zoster prevention in older adults. Those who were vaccinated with the live varicella zoster vaccine as children are less likely to develop shingles throughout their lives, since the vaccine strain of the virus appears less likely than the wild one to undergo reactivation. Still, how well being vaccinated as a child protects against manifesting zoster as an adult is not yet known. In the end, regardless of previous vaccination or previous episodes of zoster, vaccination with the recombinant vaccine is almost universally recommended for adults over 50 years old to prevent shingles. Since we are not sure of the protection afforded by being vaccinated as a child or having already manifested zoster once, please bear in mind, however, the different guidelines will sometimes contradict each other on treatment and prevention recommendations. Expect updates as new studies are published. There is also an immunoglobulin for patients at risk for severe zoster who happen to have been exposed recently to the virus. It's estimated 10 to 30% of people infected by the varicella zoster virus will eventually develop shingles, a lifetime incidence rate that rises to 50% in those older than 85 years old. Overall, the incidence is 4 per 1,000 per year in the general population and 1% per year on those above 6 years of age. Herpes zoster does not appear to show sex predilection, according to most sources, but it is significantly more common in Caucasian people. Thank you for watching this video and for choosing to spend your time with me. Please bear in mind that this is not medical advice, this is only meant as a review. If you believe you or someone you know may have herpes zoster or shingles, please seek your physician. If you believe one of our patients may have shingles, please check the latest protocols. Thank you once more for choosing to spend your time with me. If you are interested in medical themes, please make sure to check my videos or playlists on these topics. And I hope to see you on the next video.